the Joe Rogan Experience.
It's way more fascinating when someone like you talks about it versus some fucking random kook. You know, that's what makes me incredibly interested, is the just your credibility and the fact that this is not, you don't have a history of seeing wacky shit that other people don't see.
No, just this once.
But it's on video, and that there's other ones as well. It's really strange. And I've seen people try to explain it away, and what I don't like about when they explain it away or attempt to explain it away is that they're trying really hard. They're not going, who knows what this fucking thing is? They're not looking at it like cleanly. They're looking at it like a quote-unquote skeptic. I don't like the idea of being a skeptic. Not that I don't think you should be skeptical of certain things. I certainly think you should be. But there's a lot of people that brand themselves as skeptics. And I think it's a lazy way to look at things. I really do. Because I think you're just looking for the holes in things without looking at it objectively. If you wanted to be a scientist, if you wanted to be someone who is a fan of science, then you have to look at it as a thing. Like, look at this information and let's study this without any bias, any preconceived notions. I don't think they're doing that. They're looking at it and they're trying to find a way where they can justify that it's fake. And they're just doing all sorts of mental gymnastics to try to make it fake. That video that you show where that thing slips off to the left and takes off at incredible rates of speed, that alone should freak people the fuck out.
Yeah, well, I think because people confuse all the time, like, we took the video. No, it was another crew that took the video. We watched it for 5 minutes with our eyeballs, and there was four of us. And we all have the same story. We all saw the same stuff. We all came back and looked at each other and scratched our head and said, WTF, you know, I mean, serious? What was that? You know, and then what do? You move on. We never saw it again. Yeah, I imagine they probably saw him on radar after that, but I think...
They're probably seeing him on radar all the time. They just don't bring it to the attention of the general public.
Oh, yeah, because if you don't, you know, for a ship, when they see something, and you know, you go, what is that? Well, right. You don't have any way to go out there and look at it.
Like, you know, when you're talking about how they were informing you that they were seeing these things previous to your mission, when you're doing this exercise and they let you know that they're seeing these things, did you say, hey, how frequent is this? Is this something that happens all the time?
I didn't get into that. Ours was more of the moment of, you know, when he's telling us, hey, for the last 2 weeks we've been tracking these things.
Right.
And we don't know what they are.
But you don't know whether or not it was just those 2 weeks, or maybe it was a year ago. There was other similar situations, or
there's other situations that have happened out there. But yeah, I would say, you know, for this, I don't even know. One, you got to take it serious. Yeah. We have a tendency, if we don't know what it is, if we just ignore it, it'll go away. You know, and I joke, you know, there was an incident years, it's probably not too far off the same time frame, where I think it was like the Constellation was doing her workups before she got decommissioned. And an Oscar class, a Soviet Oscar class submarine surfaced behind her, right? And then now it's like, you know, go to battle stations, World War III. How did this foreign submarine get in our area and has been monitoring our workups? That's a big deal.
Right.
I said, but now we go out and we have these things that are coming at will, and there's nothing we can do about it. We don't know what they are. We have confirmed sighting by two aircrew, four of us, two planes, that said, look, this is not an airplane. This is not a weather balloon. This is not a blip. It has performance well beyond, you know, and the airplanes that we were flying at the time were literally brand new Super Hornets right out of the Boeing factory. I mean, these were brand new first Block 2 series that came out. And you go, why wasn't something done? You know, it's like, we don't know what it is. I think it's good now, you know, the moves that have happened over the last, you know, 2 years since the original article came out, that, you know, they're now there's a new reporting for the pilots. The Navy's acknowledged, hey, these things, we don't know what they were. You know, they're starting to take it serious because, you know, I know there are other events that are not out, recent events where people have been called in to go, hey, I've seen this thing. So the investigation process is still going on. You know, we don't stop. The military doesn't stop. Even if you take funding away, we don't stop. You know, we don't stop until we're told to stop. So, you know, what's going on? You go, well, ATIP ended. You know, they spent $4.5 million a year on it. I think it was $4 million. It's $22 million over the 5 years. So you go, what are they doing since then? Well, I mean, I'm pretty sure there's still people looking at this, and there's still people that are taking this serious. I will tell you that I won't get into specifics, but there are people inside the United States government that are taking this serious. And I've been down to DC twice to talk to folks, you know, behind closed doors to go, because they want to hear the story. And I've got a lot of, you got to be joking. I mean, this seriously happened. And I'm like, yeah, it did happen. And it is real. You know, what are you doing about it?
So what kind of people are you talking to?
High level government officials is what I'll say. And most of that is because that conversation is between me and them, and I don't want people speculating, but you can say high-level government officials I have talked to.
Well, that was always the speculation about, like, what would someone do if they became president? Well, the first thing I would do is I would tell everybody about the UFOs. I would ask immediately what's going on. And I always thought about it. I said, how many people actually know what's going on and how much of the information? I mean, it's not like – if they're dealing with something like this, like your experience, it seems like what you described is what is known. So it's this anomalous event where this thing defies our current understanding of technology, and then it's gone.
Yes.
And so what do you have? You don't have anything else other than that. Like, what other information does anybody have?
Well, I would say this, because I've talked to Bob.
Bob Lazar.
Yeah, we did an event together, and I'll leave it to everyone to. It's up to you to believe Bob. I'll say this: Bob's a normal guy. Bob's not crazy.
He's not crazy at all.
Not at all.
That was the weirdest thing about talking to him.
But when you look at it and go, because I had asked Bob, I said, what he describes in the technology that when he talks about his story, I said, well, do you honestly think we could, you know, reverse engineer it? I said, how long do you think it would take us? And his response to me was another 100 years. He goes, Dave, it was so far beyond. He goes, the stuff that he says he worked on. He's like, you know, he was on your podcast because I watched it. You know, hey, there was no wires. And because I had asked him when he said you first described the ship that he got to see, he said, I used to say, you know, they built it and then it was like wax and you'd heat it up. He goes, now I would say it was built with 3D printing, because now with 3D printing, we can build things literally from the ground up, and it's basically built as one. Not panels, no rivets, it's just made.
Right.
And so when you talk about that and you go, well, it's still another 100 years. So you go, well, what if you had the technology? We still, if what Bob says is correct, we still don't understand it. And how fast would it take us to understand that? I mean, if it's driven by something that we don't even have on Earth, which is when he talks about that element, we can't create it. You know, we can create it for a microsecond, and then it decays, and we go,
element
okay,
115.
Yeah. So, you know, I think we're still a long ways off. You know, I'll argue with the people that go, you know, are we really alone? I was telling Jeremy, we used to go out on goggles. You know, out in the middle of the Pacific, there's no light pollution.
Goggles?
Night vision goggles, so okay. We can see. Well, you go out at night, I'd be on like a tanker hop or something, just hanging out, not doing anything, driving around in circles with the autopilot on. You just turn all the lights down in the cockpit so you have no night light pollution, and you just roll your head back and look up. There's billions and billions and billions of stars out there. And, you know, I always look up because I'm like, you know, are we alone? And I look up and go, well, if we're the only ones around, and everything I'm looking at, it's a pretty sad place. It's a pretty lonely universe. I asked my astrophysics prof that once. I said, you believe in extraterrestrial life? And she's like, of course not. And I said, well, there's billions and billions of planets. You think we're it? I mean, just the probability of it is you'd go, oh, there's probably something else out there. And I'm not crazy. I'm just opening up the possibility that we are not the only planet that has life on it.
I think people don't like to seem silly. They don't like to be foolish. And I think when people start talking about anything that's not proven or anything that's connected to a bunch of loony people that are making up stories, which UFOs certainly are.
Yes.
UFOs are connected to so many people that have made up so many stories. What was that gentleman's name from – you would know that guy. He was from another country. Billy something or another.
Billy Meyer.
Billy Myers,
yeah.
Seems 100% full of shit. Correct?
Yeah, yeah. He's proven to have done tons of hoaxes with this, but here's the deal. Sometimes I think people have a real experience, and they're always like chasing that dragon, and they get UFO disease, and the brain goes fucking berserk, right? I know that there are people that have had profound experiences, and then they can't ever replicate them, so then they just start going crazy. And I don't blame them for it. But you got someone like Commander Fravor, when he saw that AAV, anomalous aerospace vehicle, his reaction was, I want to fly it. That's a pretty cool reaction. I'd like to fly it.
Yeah, imagine flying that thing.
Well, that's what I told my buddy. He was my XO at the time, Dell. I got back after all this happened. He looks at me, and we're just standing in the ready room, and he goes, "Hey, dude." I go, "What?" He goes, "What do you think it is?" I go, "I have no idea, but it was pretty freaking impressive, and I'd like to fly it."
Of course.
And he goes, "Yeah." I go, "I mean, it was, you know, it's just like any pot. You always want to fly the coolest thing.
Of course. Yeah, of course. You're a race car driver. You want to drive the fastest car.
That's it. And now you look at it and go, well, that's something we don't have.
Yeah.
This idea that, you know, maybe we're not alone, that some of these other stars have planets that are maybe technologically advanced. So the next thing people say, and, you know, new eras are going to say, well, they're not coming here because the distance is so vast. Hold the fuck up. From the very beginning, when Bob Lazar came forward and talked about field propulsion, gravity propulsion, distance becomes completely irrelevant. So if we believe, and the radars are right, and Commander Fravor saw this thing moving like a ping pong ball in a glass of water, it's gravity propelled. That's why you can make those maneuvers without exploding, okay? Then distance becomes completely irrelevant for travel. You're literally warping time and space. You're falling into place.
It's like the idea of showing someone a video on your phone long before video was ever invented. People would be like, what are you talking about? Like before photography was invented, which is shockingly recent, right? You had to draw pictures of things you saw, just like those people that drew or painted that those images of those men and whatever those things were with Christ in the background. The idea that we could understand what some insanely impressive technology from a planet that is nowhere near us could manifest. It's nuts.
Yeah, Bob Lazar talks a lot about this. Remember, he's a young guy, right? In 1989, he gets shown something. And all of a sudden, he's trying to interpret it through 1989 technology. So he said, it looks like it was injection molded, because that's what he had. And then I sent him this thing about nanotechnology and, you know, working towards an atomic printer. He's like, dude, that makes a lot more sense. So he has to view it through where he saw it in 1989. However, I will say this. It is my knowledge that we understand exactly how these craft work. Our one limiting factor is our material science. We can't replicate, not the fuel source itself is another.
When you say we know exactly how they work.
Yeah, it doesn't break our laws of physics. This concept of amplification of gravity, this concept of gravity propulsion. We understand how things can move from point A to point B almost instantaneously. Our physics doesn't disallow it, but our material science and the fuel to create that machine that we have machines from other places. So
what do you mean?
Well, Bob Lazar, whether you believe him or not, there was a program. I have other witnesses that I will be bringing forward about S4, where he worked. We have craft.
You have other witnesses that worked with alongside
Bob?
No,
people that corroborate Bob's account in that they saw him get on and off the red and whites, the Janet flights that come on.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody that went to Papoose Lake and was stopped by non-military guards at that time, people that we're aware of, Site 4 and ET exploitation projects. One is an SR-71 pilot that I've been talking with for a couple years. So these people are coming forward now, and it's like I'm sick and tired of doing it, these little nitpicky things about Bob. Okay, there was a program. There was a back engineering program. They've admitted there are materials. So this is like the metamaterials you heard about in the New York Times, all that. We have materials associated with UFOs that are interesting.
What is that? What are you talking about?
So this was something that was launched in the first New York Times article, I believe in December of 2017, that there is studies being done right now on materials associated with UFOs, right? So actual metals that have come off of, you could say, crashes or
now, who is that that explained that there was something, that they were with Eric Weinstein, that was explaining that there was someone who reportedly has something along those lines?
Jacques Vallée has 17 samples.
17 samples. How does one guy get 17 samples?
Well, he's Jacques fucking Vallée, right? So he's the guy first ever for the United States military created a computer program for the study of UFOs for Project Blue Book. So he's an old school guy. They modeled him after in the Close Encounters movie. It's modeled after Jacques Vallée, the French guy. So he's kind of like been involved with this. He's had more access to government databases than any of us. He went around, collected samples from known, you know, crashes or like when things will come off.
And what's the conclusion?
Well, they're studying them right now. There was just something on Fox about it. They're studying some of these materials and what they will find, because the ones they're talking about, I actually took to New Mexico and had five scientists study it about 5 years ago. I got my hands on it, got to study it, the famous parts they're talking about now. it's layered. And the way it's layered is what they're trying to see if it's anomalous elementally, or the way that the elements are bound together, and also the atomic level of layering is what's interesting. We'll find out if
it's interesting. Explain what you're talking about. What is this thing that you saw?
Okay, well, there are a lot of different samples, but when you get a sample of something and you can
see... How big are these samples?
The ones that I looked at,
yes.
They ranged from about this size down...
audio.
They ranged from the size of...
an orange?
Yeah, size of an orange to the size of a quarter. These are materials, right?
And are they materials from a crash?
So that's allegedly, or there's a known crash. This is in the public domain rather than government controlled. So what I was looking at, or having the scientists look at, is isotopically and elementally. What are the elements that are in this? Are they engineered?
And what's the conclusion?
Well, I'm going to leave it to the people that are doing it now, who have much better machines than I had.
Do you know any cliff notes?
Yeah, they from what I understand, there's atomic layering. There are levels of, like we do with graphene. We lay down these layers that are basically oriented at a certain degree. That's how you get a superconductor or something like that. If you take a piece of graphene and it's highly machined, so it's not doesn't deviate from that atomic layering, you can push it right through ice like a hot knife through butter. It's the weirdest feeling in the world, because you just take this piece of what feels like graphene and it just goes right through butter, because it's a superconductor and the heat from your hand melts the ice. So that is a metamaterial. It doesn't occur naturally. Humans created it, and it has special properties because of the way it's atomically layered. So if these materials are from somewhere else, then we suspect that they're going to be highly machined, that they're going to be created for special use. So my whole point is, our material science has not caught up with the physics that we understand for these field propulsion systems. I'm just telling you, believe me or not, but you'll hear more about it, that our material science in 1989 and today is our limiting factor. And as our material science gets better as humans, we know how these things work. Now, the fuel source, that's a whole nother conversation. But as far as creating these machines, that's what we're trying to do. That's why there is secrecy. We're trying to exploit the technology, because whoever exploits it first wins. It's a game changer. We don't want Russia to do it. We don't want China to do it. If we had a non-reactionary propulsion system, the world would look different instantaneously.